Hello everyone, and welcome to this Moodle Academy webinar, Introduction to Moodle for Administrators. I am Mary Cooch, Education Manager at Moodle HQ, and with me I have Anna Krasser, who is Education Advisor. Anna?
Hello everyone, thank you for joining us today. I'm sure it's going to be a very interesting session with all of you here.
Good. So during the session, just to let you know, we will be pausing the presentation at intervals so that we can read out and answer any of your questions and queries. Okay, so let's begin. And we're going to look at learning Moodle from the very beginning. And it's important to understand that if you're new to Moodle, there are two parts to understanding how it works. There is what we call the administration part, and that is, for example, making your Moodle site look attractive, branding it, adding teachers and students, adding spaces for the learning materials and resources. But there's also what we call teaching with Moodle, which is what you do in a course, how you add your activities, your examinations, your quizzes, your files and so on. And that is something that we're not looking at today. We're focusing on administration, but we have a webinar next week, same time next week, Introduction to Moodle for Educators. And in that webinar, you will be introduced to how you can use Moodle's activities for your teaching. Together, both of these webinars hopefully will give you a good beginner picture of how to use Moodle. Now, of course, Moodle is entirely free and open source to anyone in the world. So you could go to our downloads site and download Moodle and install it yourself and start using it. Perhaps some of you have. That's fine. It's not for everyone, though, because you do need some technical understanding. So another way of getting Moodle is to have a Moodle that's already hosted online. By a company, there are many companies out there, by our officially certified Moodle service providers, our Moodle partners, or again, if you're not particularly technical and you just want to try Moodle and then use it for yourself, you can use Moodle Cloud. Moodle Cloud is our Moodle HQ provided ready to use Moodle service. And you simply go to Moodle Cloud, sign up, and you can have a site. You can try it for free for 45 days, and then you can either continue by paying or get Moodle in another way. But what we're going to look at in our administration webinar today is not the technical side of installing Moodle and all of that on the server. We're going to look at how you can be a Moodle administrator from within the admin interface of Moodle. And we're going to focus on, well, we're going to look at Moodle Cloud sites, but everything we say also applies to a Moodle site that you have hosted online somewhere else, or even that you've done yourself. And so this is what we're going to look at. We're going to explore the main admin settings that you need, including how you can customize your site, make it more colorful, add images, brand it, and so on. And in fact, that's the first thing we're going to do, both of those. Then we're going to look at how you can add what Moodle calls the courses. So that's the teaching and learning spaces where you add the materials. Then once we've got our courses set up and hopefully we've added some teaching materials, how you can add your teachers and students. And then I'm going to give you a few quick tips as to where you can go and what you can do to find out more, because of course we cannot do everything just in a short 1 hour webinar. So let's get started exploring the main admin settings and customizing our site to a basic degree. Of course, to do all of this, we need to log in as an administrator to our brand new Moodle site. I'm logging in here to a Moodle Cloud site. And an important difference, by the way, is if you're using Moodle Cloud, you don't see an open to the world front page, site home we call it. You just see the login page until you're logged in. If you have a Moodle site from a hosting company or you've set it up yourself, normally you would be able to see that front page without a login. So we're going to log in to a Moodle site for the first time. This applies to all sites. And this is what we see. It's very empty. We have a nice welcome message to us as the new admin. There are no courses available because we haven't done anything. And if you look top left, it says your school, which is not my name of choice. This is the name for my site that I was given when I set it up. Obviously, I'm going to want to change that. And you'll see at the top, there are some links. Dashboard, My Courses, Site Administration. Now, site administration is only seen by us, the admin, and that's where we will spend most of our time today. Dashboard and My Courses are useful for your teachers and students, but obviously if we looked on this site here, we'd see nothing because we haven't done anything. So I'm going to take you quickly to another Moodle site where a student has been working in courses over several months, so you can see what it looks like in action. So if we click the dashboard link to go to another Moodle site, our student here sees a timeline of assignments, activities that she needs to complete. She has deadlines in them. She also sees a calendar of events which can be personal to her or set up by the teacher in the courses. And she may well also have a little block showing her where she was last in a course so she can go back to that course and continue where she left off. In fact, you, the admin, you can define what is seen on this dashboard page for everyone in the site. In terms of her courses, if she clicks the My Courses link at the top of the page, she sees all of the courses she's enrolled in. She can filter them by, as she has now, in progress. You see the tab at the left, or she can click to find the past ones, the completed ones, the future ones. And you'll see there are some nice images with the names of the courses. The teacher or the admin can add these images to make it look more attractive. You don't have to. And you also notice that it has completion percentages. So our student can see how much of the course she's already completed, what she has yet to do. And if you are thinking, well, I don't want that because my courses will only ever have some files and they won't have a start or end date, that's fine. You can turn that off if you want to. Okay. But all of those things, obviously, you need to do as an administrator. And our student doesn't have site admin link at the top because she's just a student. So let's go back to our completely blank Moodle site as a site administrator and click the site administration link. And now you can see that we have various links or tabs across the page, which take us logically to different parts of the site admin. For example, if we want to start making courses, we would click courses. If we want to improve how our site looks, which is what we're going to do now, we would click appearance. Now, you don't need as an admin to remember where everything is. So you can quite simply click where it says search, type in a word, and then Moodle will suggest you some places that you might want to go to. Now, I think the first thing that we should do is change that annoying your school top left, which is the short name of the site, and change it to the name that I want for my Moodle site. And that is actually already on this first general tab. If we move down a little bit, where it says site home is Moodle's front page. And if we click the link, site home settings, this is where we can change the full name and the short name. So the full name is in big, the short name is up there on the left, as you can see. They can be the same if they're not too long. I'm just going to change mine to Cloud Control. I just thought the name up. It's whatever you need your site to be called. You can give it a summary here. However, this summary, as it is now, appears in the side of your site. It might not be exactly what you want. But if we go a little bit further down, there are a couple of other settings useful to know. If your site is not a Moodle Cloud site and the front page is visible to everyone, you can define from the top dropdowns what you want people to see when they come to your site. For example, the list of available courses. And for every type of Moodle site, you can also define what you want to be visible on the front page once people have logged in. Now, there are other settings, but we're just going to get started for now. And a very important tip to remember is always to go to the bottom of your page and click Save Changes so that we've saved our changes. And if I now move on, you'll see where my number one is top left. I've now changed the name of the site, Cloud Control. It's no longer your school. And so what we're going to do now is to see if we can improve this very bland white appearance of the site. And so we need to click the Appearance tab. So if we click where I've got my number two, if we click Appearance, we have a section called Appearance. And in there, just to point out, for example, if you see we have default dashboard page. So if you wanted to decide what people would see on that dashboard page as the admin, you can do it there. I also want to point out to you the link navigation, because if we click navigation, perhaps you might be someone who was thinking, I don't need a timeline of activity deadlines or a calendar because my site is always, my courses are always available and they're just files. From navigation, you can actually untick or uncheck so the dashboard isn't seen by anyone. Equally, on start page for users, you can decide where to send your teachers and students once they've logged in. Do you want them to go straight to the My Courses page? Do you want them to stay on the home page, or do you want them to be able to decide for themselves? So these are just a couple of examples of what you can see from the navigation link, which is in Appearance. Let's go back to that Appearance tab. And if we look at Themes towards the bottom, Themes is basically a skin or a background to make your site look more attractive. Moodle Cloud sites have one theme which comes as standard called Boost. If you have another site from another hosting company or you installed it yourself, you'll also see there right at the bottom, as well as Boost, there is a theme called Classic. And what's good about these themes is if you just click the name of them, so if I click where it says Boost, it takes me to the settings page for that theme where I can make some simple changes. So we have a general settings tab and an advanced settings tab. Any of you who are good with CSS, you can click the advanced settings tab and add some CSS to improve the color and the display of this theme on your site. I'm not very good at that, but I am interested in the general settings tab. So for example, if you have a colleague or a friend who is good at creating a set of settings for a theme, which we'd call a preset, you could upload it here and that would change your site very easily. What I like is if we scroll down a little bit on this page, you can upload a background image. So you wouldn't have the plain white. You could also upload a login page background image so that when people log into the site, it looks more attractive. And this is where you can do branding of your site. Also, if you look to the very bottom of the screen, you can just by clicking in the colors there, you can choose a brand color and decide what kind of colors you want for the text and the titles and so on. To show you as an example, I actually uploaded a login page background image to my site or to one of my sites. And so now people come to the site and they see beautiful sunflowers. This might not be to your taste, but it's just demonstrating that even though you have a simple site, you can easily customize it. But it might be possible for you to do even more than that. So this does not apply to Moodle Cloud sites, because in Moodle Cloud sites, you cannot install extra things, extra themes. However, if you have your own site or with a different company, you need to click where it says plugins. And if you click plugins, if you can actually see the words install plugins, this means that you can upload from that link one of our many free themes which Moodle offers, which Moodle contributors have given to Moodle, and you can upload, install one of those. A theme is a plugin because it's something extra to the standard. And then you can have many other different ways of showing your Moodle site. So you can go from the very simple color changes to a quite different look by installing a theme from install plugins, okay? Not on Moodle Cloud, but elsewhere in other Moodle sites. Now, that's quite a lot to begin with, so I'm going to pause there. And before we go on to the next part of the webinar, I'm going to stop and I'm going to ask Anna if there are any comments or questions that we can cover for a couple of minutes about setting up your site.
Okay. Well, we have lots of greetings from all over the world, as we mentioned before. And we have a question from Andrew. He says, he asks, why can you install themes on Moodle Cloud?
The reason is quite simply that Moodle Cloud offers a limited but very, very easy to use set of features for Moodle. And it's the same for everyone. And we have hundreds and hundreds of sites around the world. So So in order to keep it secure and safe and modern and up to date, there are certain limitations. But we do say that if you want to have extra plugins and you want to have more functionality, more users, then we strongly recommend you go the next step up, which is to our Moodle partners. There is a Moodle Cloud FAQ. If you go to Moodle Cloud or if you have a site and you go to your portal, and this question is dealt with in more detail there.
Great. And we have Robert who's asking, what are the image sizes required for the homepage images?
Do you mean the course, the images for courses or for the front page? For courses, I tend myself, and we're going to look at this in a moment, to use 600 by 400. For the actual, for the login page or the background image, I can't remember immediately, but I think if we go to the documentation, and again, I'm going to show you the quick way to go there, it should say there. If it doesn't, I'll make sure that it does, yeah? Because one of the ways that you can learn more about Moodle is by accessing the documentation. And of course, if we have any people in the chat who are already using Moodle, you might know the answer if we don't. Okay. Well,
as far as remember, for the front page, you need a high quality image. It's good to have a big one.
Yes.
Now, Lynn says, can I customize the login on Moodle Cloud side?
Can you customize the?
The login page.
Oh, yes, you can. Yes, you can. Yes.
And Stefan says, what is the size and format preferences for a logo?
The size and format preferences for the logo are also in the documentation. So unless someone has the answer there, I will suggest that you go and look at the documentation as well. And after this webinar, I'll go and check it myself to make sure it's up to date. Okay.
Well, for sure, the format is an image, so it could be a PNG or JPEG image, something like that.
Yeah, that's right. Because it's an image. I'm not sure about the size, but we can find out for you. Okay, would you go on?
And one last one from Eric. Can we change at will all the settings?
Can we change at will all of the settings? Well, as an administrator, there is a lot that you can do, yes. So you have great power, but also great responsibility, yes. And there are some settings in Moodle Cloud that you can't change, but you will notice those because when you go into the site admin in Moodle Cloud, if it says something like defined in config PHP, that means you can't change it in Moodle Cloud. But most of it you can do, you can change in Moodle Cloud just as with other Moodle sites. Okay, shall we move on?
Yes, yes, I think we are ready.
Right, so now we've got our site set up and we've added an image and it's quite attractive. We're going to look at how we can add what Moodle calls courses, which are the spaces or the pages where teachers teach and learners learn. And so it makes sense that we click Site Administration and then we go to the link called Courses. Now, here I'm going to explain three ways of adding courses to your Moodle site, my 1, 2, and 3. And the first way, add a new course, is quite simply where you, the administrator, you manually create one single individual course. This is very easy. It's fine if you are, for example, homeschooling and you only need a few courses. It's not so good if you want a lot of courses on a big site. So we'll look at other ways as well. If you click the link, add a new course, then you're prompted to give it a full name and a short name. Again, they can be the same. And I was, just to explain, I was a languages teacher for 28 years before I joined Moodle. So I always think of French, it's always my example, but you can call your courses whatever is relevant to the topic you're teaching. And then, category, Moodle comes with a default category, which is either called Category 1 or Miscellaneous. And this can be changed by you if you don't like the name. If you're very organized and you like to organize your courses into different categories, you can also create other categories and move your courses into there. I'll show you where in a moment. But for now, if we scroll down, out of the many settings, something else that is useful is to add a description of the course and also a course image. And this is what we saw when we were, looking at the dashboard, the My Courses page. Our student had quite a few images with course descriptions. So I'm going to add that. Okay. And then another thing that you might be interested in is the course format. So this is how the activities are divided up on the course page in the sections. Weekly formats means that they will show the weeks depending on when your course starts. However, if you're not using weeks, if your course is available and it's not time dependent, you could use topics format. I prefer topics format, for example, because you get numbered sections. And me, in my French course, I would change the numbers to listening, reading, speaking, writing, and add relevant materials in there. Anytime you're not sure of something, click those question mark icons next to a setting, and it gives you some puts and help in a pop-up. There are other settings you would click to expand them. We will look at more of these next week in the Moodle Educator webinar. But for now, again, as always, we click the button at the bottom, Save and Display, and we have a first new course. And if you remember, when we first came to our homepage, we had nothing on it, available courses, none. Now, we've got one course and you can see the image and you can see its title. Now that's fine. However, as I said to you, if you're going to make a lot of courses or if you've already got a course that someone has made and given you, add a new course, number one, is not very helpful. So we're now going to look at number two, which is called Restore Course. This is where you would go if you've got a ready-made existing Moodle course. Maybe your colleague has given it to you, or maybe you went on a training day, you created a practice course and the trainer got you to save that so you could add it to your new Moodle site. So you're basically here, if we click Restore Course, you are uploading what Moodle calls a backup file. That is an existing course, okay? So this is where you go to upload a ready-made course, a backup, and you need to ensure that your course ends in .mbz. That is the format, the correct format of a Moodle course backup to add to this restore course, Nick. And I strongly advise you, and I'm sure Anna will too, go to our site MoodleNet, which is where we have lots of resources for everyone using Moodle. And we have nearly 70 sample or example courses that you could add, you could restore to your Moodle site to try to adapt, to explore. You don't have to use them as they are. You can look at them and change them to fit you, or just to see how Moodle activities work. So please do try that. Okay, so we've looked at adding a course individually. We've looked at how you can upload or restore an existing course. But if you've got a large site or you're expecting to have a lot of courses, then you would need to click the link, number 3, upload courses. Upload courses is not a very good name because you're not actually creating the courses yourself. You are uploading a spreadsheet with course information so that Moodle can then create the courses for you. So if we click this link, again, we're going to choose a file and we need to make sure it's the correct format. So these are not ready-made courses. You're uploading the course information, not an existing course. And it should end in .csv. It's a CSV file with the name, the category, and so on of the courses. And you could have a long list of them. Again, if you need help, click that question mark icon. But here is a good time for me to point out to you that on Moodle 4 courses, Moodle 4 is the latest version of Moodle, bottom right, you'll see a question mark icon. And wherever you are as an admin or a teacher on your Moodle site, if you click the question mark icon, you will see a link that says help and documentation. And that takes you directly to the Moodle documentation page that's relevant to the place where you are at the moment in context help. So if, for example, you need to know how to format your CSV file to upload course information, clicking there will take you straight to the documentation page where you'll see an example CSV file that you can use. Okay, so that's 3 ways you can create your courses on your new Moodle site. Before we pause again, I want to point out 2 other useful links. Manage courses and categories is where you can go if, as I said, you wanted to change the name of the default category from category 1 or miscellaneous to a name that suits you, or you want to organize your courses into other categories and subcategories. Course default settings is also useful for you to explore if you want to ensure consistency across all the courses on your site. For example, you want them all to be topics format, or you want specific ways people can enroll in them. So those are 2 useful links once you've created your courses. Okay, there is much more we can say, but I feel it's time to pause again and answer any more questions or any more issues which are being raised. So I'm going to pass over to Anna again.
Yes, Taguchi says his own experience, they have organizing a self-paced learning course for 10,000 learners worldwide. And they started from a pilot and received lots of feedback from the learners that the platform was not intuitive and the interface was not user-friendly. Now they want to improve it before the second phase of the project, and how they can, he's asking how they can receive a customized support from Moodle. Well, I address already this case as a case that would be better to be dealt with the expertise of a Moodle certified provider. Viswanath provided some information about the logo and the optimum size. And he says that the optimum size of the logo depends on the theme that is used. But with some CSS tricks, always you can get the look that you want. That's true. If you have the technical background. This one I've informed that Moodle was not initially set up as a platform for MOOCs. There are, though, variations of Moodle that are more tailored in for MOOCs, and there are information in Moodle.org forums.
Yes, I would question that a little bit, because if you think about it, the site itself, Moodle.org, which is over 20 years old, has million users and has been used regularly. And in a sense, that is a kind of a permanent ongoing MOOC. Up until a couple of years ago, we had a site, learn.moodle.org, which was a completely regular, normal Moodle site, which again, we used for a twice yearly Moodle MOOC. So it is available. It depends on, again, how the performance is set up and so on and so forth. I do very much agree that for questions like this and other Moodle admin related questions, do please go to our community forums on Moodle.org. That's one of the places I'm going to remind you of in the last section, where we look at where you can find out more. Okay, anything else, or shall we?
Yes, Martin says, how can I backup courses, and can I then restore them just when needed? Because she needs to save disk space.
Yes, absolutely. If you go to site administration, courses, or if you can't remember, then remember to go to the search box, and you can type it in then, backup. You can see various options for backing up the whole site, regular course backups. And if you go inside a course, now this is something that we will look at next week in the Moodle for Educators webinar. If you go inside a course and you click the More link inside a course, Course Reuse is where you can go to back up your course, and then you can simply download it and put it somewhere else for safekeeping, so you don't have to keep it on your Moodle site. So you can very easily do that in different ways, okay? And that is where you would go if you wanted to share a course with someone else, and then they would use the restore course option to restore it, okay?
Yes, Risa said that on my Moodle site, the courses in my courses tab are displayed as a list. Where can I go to change how courses are displayed?
Okay.
So have them as a card layout.
Yeah, so when you go to that page, you should have an option at the top left, right, to, and you can choose from card view or list view. So there are various ways to display the courses. I just showed you the one which has what we call cards, because it's more attractive with the images, but you can go to the top and change it if the admin has allowed. So there is an admin setting in appearance where these kinds of things are that might force people only to use one course display. But then again, if you don't have that option to view them as cards, as I've shown you, then you need either to ask your administrator to give you that option, or as the administrator, go into the appearance section and find it for yourself. But there are ways of displaying it in other ways, okay?
And William says that Moodle has course backups and site backups that are very good, and suggest that to check backup and restore just the parts they want or the whole course. And he says that I often copy activities from one course into another this way with just a few mouse clicks. And Lisa says that she has a difficulty restoring the Moodle site due to its size. Are there any suggestions?
She has frequently problems restoring courses into
Moodle. She has a difficulty restoring the Moodle site because the site is too big.
Right, okay. These are the kinds of questions that I suggest you ask in our forums on Moodle.org, because it's not exactly a kind of a beginner admin question here where we're just covering the very start of admin. But I'm so glad that you're asking these questions so that you understand the best place to go for some help. So Moodle.org, and there are various forums there, for instance, an installing and upgrading forum where you can get some advice on topics like that. We'll focus on the basic beginner admin here.
And the last one we have, it's for Verena. How can I display the whole picture in a course, not only a small part of it?
I'm not quite sure what, can you understand what she means, Anna?
I think she's referring to the dashboard where other courses appear as tiles. So I think it depends on the size of your image. Perhaps you should play with that.
Yeah, what you will see in that tile depends on what you've got on the image. So if you want to show everything that's in the image, you would have to play, as Anna says, with the size of the image, and it might not look quite right. I always try to find images that display well. Sometimes it takes several tries, different attempts to get an image that looks okay, really. And not with text, because that possibly could be too small and not particularly accessible. Okay, I think we'd better continue so that we are not too over time. And we have a very important section now, extremely important, which is adding teachers and students. Let's assume that we've created our courses and that perhaps we've been to next week's webinar. We learn how to make great Moodle teaching activities. So it's worth adding teachers and students. It's very important before we do this to understand a little bit about how Moodle's hierarchy works and how Moodle thinks about teachers and students. So in your Moodle site, and here is a graphic of a blue and orange house, which you can imagine is your Moodle site. You are the administrator. You can do anything everywhere. So as I already said, that is great power, but also great responsibility, because it means you can break everything. That's why it's good to have training such as this webinar and the subsequent links I'm going to give you, so you are comfortable being a Moodle admin. And if you want a friend or colleague also to be the admin, do make sure they also have got some understanding and training on how to be an administrator. Everyone else who comes to your site, when they log in, they are an authenticated user. That's just the term Moodle gives for anyone else on the site. They can go to your site, they can log in, but they can't do anything. They only become a teacher or a student when they go into individual courses. You don't log in to Moodle as a teacher. You don't log into Moodle as a student. What you are depends on what course you're in and what the admin has decreed, okay? And there are two terms which it's important to understand for this, because it's a two-step process. First, you need to get on the site, then you need to get into the course. Authentication means getting people onto your site, giving them accounts, letting them create their own accounts. And then enrollment means getting people into your courses, adding them yourself or letting them sign up yourself to your courses. Enrollment with one L if you are British or Australian English, enrollment with two L's if you're American English. Neither, both are correct. It's not a spelling mistake. And it's important to know these two terms, because if you do have a problem with your Moodle site, then you can use these terms correctly if you go to the forums on Moodle.org, or you ask in the portal of your Moodle Cloud site or the support in your hosted Moodle. So obviously the first thing we need to do is authentication. That's, we need to get people, Moodle calls them users, onto our Moodle site. And so we click the site administration link and then we click users. And there are many ways of getting people onto Moodle. I'm just going to show you the two most popular ways. And then a third way that I'm anticipating you're going to want, okay? And I hope you do. So the first way, number one, add a new user, is equivalent to when we went to courses and we clicked add a new course. So this is where you would individually and manually add one new user. You would give them a username. I suggest if you're going to add several, you try some for consistency, adding Moodle users. And you need to give them a password and a first name, last name, email. Now, a helpful hint is you can tick a box called generate password and notify user. And that means that instead of you making a password, Moodle will create a password and it will send that person an email telling them that they have a new account, their username and password. So that saves you some work. You can also, I have a second orange arrow pointing to a box for force password change. If you tick that, the first time this person, Alex in our case, comes to the site, they will be prompted to change their password to something they can remember. Okay. And as ever, go down and click to save the changes. And then we've got our very first manually created Moodle user. And as an admin, if you go to the list of users, you'll see that we are no longer lonely in our cloud control site. We have Alex, who is another Moodle user. However, just like when we went to add a new course, that's not very helpful if we think we're going to have hundreds of people on our site. So the second option is to click upload users. And again, this is equivalent to upload courses in that you're not actually creating them yourself. You are giving Moodle the information in a spreadsheet CSV file so that Moodle can create them for you. So if we click upload users, again, we're prompted to choose and upload a file. What's good in this case is that Moodle actually gives you an example text file that you can download and use to help you. So it shows you the formatting of the .csv file that you're going to use to add your users. And a little hint, we don't have time in this webinar, but you can include in that CSV file, not only the user's information, but the courses you want them to go into, and even whether you want them to be teachers or students in the courses. And again, if you click the question mark icons to go to the documentation, you can see examples of how to do that. Now that's fine. That's two ways that you, the admin, can add people onto your Moodle site. But I very much hope you're thinking, that's a lot of work. I don't want to do that. I want them to come to me. In other words, you want them to create their own accounts so you don't have to. Perhaps you've gone on Moodle sites and you've seen, is this your first time here? And you've seen a button where they need to create a new account. You want to do that so that you don't have to do anything. Well, for that, we need to click in Site Administration, Plugins, and we need to look at another authentication method. And again, don't worry if you can't remember this. Use the search box top right and type in there. So if we actually go to authentication, we need to click Manage Authentication because we need to manage the authentication method for letting people create their own accounts. And when we go to that page, we see something called email-based self-registration. This is basically the name for people can create their own accounts to get onto your site. And you need to open the eye. So there's a number one next to a closed eye. Click to open the eye. That will make it visible so people can sign up, create their own accounts on your Moodle site. There's an extra security setting if you go further down. In common settings, make sure that email-based self-registration is also enabled. And when you've done that and it's saved, then your people will be able to create their own accounts. So they're now on your site, but they can't actually do anything until they can get into your course, which is the other step, which is enrollment, okay? Now, enrollment takes place in courses. So what we'll do now is we will go into that course we created. You remember we manually created Basic French. So if we just click into the Basic French course that we created before, it's very empty. Next week in the webinar, Moodle for Educators, we'll look at how you can populate this with interesting resources and activities. For now, if you click the participants link, then when you click the participants link, the first thing you'll notice is a button, blue button, enroll users. This is where you can manually add people to the course. Because at the moment, if you look, it says, not participants found, nothing to display. There's nobody there. So one way is to click the enroll users button. And then we have a search box and we can search for people on the site who we want to add to this course. We only have Alex at the moment, so we can only add Alex. And then you need to assign their role. Do you want Alex to be a teacher or a student? As an admin, you have more options here than a teacher. A teacher doesn't have all these options, but you're the admin, you can do anything. So we've selected Alex. We're going to make Alex a student in the course. And we then click bottom right, the enroll users button. And Alex is now enrolled in that course. And it says enrolled users, one participant, Alex. And I do hope, again, that you're thinking, that sounds like a lot of work. I want them to sign up to the course themselves, just like they signed up to my site themselves. Okay, so if that's what you want, we're going to take a look at that now. And this is an enrollment method. So there are various methods of enrollment. So to do this, we have to go to the drop down next to the enroll users button. If we click the drop down next to the enroll users button, we'll see something called enrollment methods. And here we can see the various ways people can get into your course. What we did is called manual enrollment, and you normally always have that. But we also have here it grayed out self-enrollment. And there is an eye icon. My orange arrow is pointing to an eye icon, which is closed. We need to open the eye icon, and that will be it. Our students will be able to enroll themselves. If you wanted to, there's some extra things that you can do by clicking the cog icon next to it. So if you wanted to optionally, if you click the cog icon, you can, for example, set a password on the course or an enrollment key, as Moodle calls it, and only people who know that key can get into the course. You can also put a limit on the number of people to go into the course. If you are running a 4-week course and you don't want more than 25 people, you can set a limit. And also something nice is from there, you can personalize the welcome message that people will get once they have enrolled in your course. So those are extra options, plus other options as well from there. But again, as long as you have opened the eye of self-enrollment, then when someone logs into your site and then clicks onto the course, they will see the button Enroll Me. And they will be able to enroll themselves into that course. Okay, this one doesn't have an enrollment key because we didn't set it up. Now, that's a lot to take in, particularly because there are two steps to adding teachers and students. But I hope it's a little bit clearer. And I'm going to pause for one final time here to see what we have. And then after that, as we draw to the close of the hour, I will give you some hints as to where you can go for more information. So, Anna, what do we have now?
Well, we have some interesting discussions in the chat. And I'm saying discussion because we have questions and we also have answers.
Excellent.
All right, so I will quickly go through them. Okay. Robert asked if Moodle supports single sign-on. Yeah. And the answer is yes. And Viswanath offered a more professional, I would say, answer, saying that It might not have, yes, in principle, but you might not have the SSO you have in your institution. In that case, you need to make a plugin for that. And he also provided a link to the plugins for authentication.
Thank you.
Tazin said that, about the Zoom recording, and I clarify that Zoom recording will be available as soon as we have it, tomorrow probably, as a draft inside the course. And a little bit later, we will provide the edited version, and it will be also shared through YouTube.
Yes.
Andrew asked about LTI, what is LTI? And Alex responded that it's the learning tools interoperability. With the link, we have really professional people.
That's
here.
Good.
Okay. Edward asked how to have users created through social media accounts.
Well, you can create them via Gmail or Microsoft Outlook or Facebook. It's called OAuth2. We didn't cover it here because, again, it's an extra step and we only have an hour. But there is some documentation, if you look up OAuth2, to explain the process for that.
Dawn is asking, as an admin, is there a facility to view dashboard as a student?
I would always advise, if you are an admin, to have a separate account where you are a student. Because however you view things, whether you're a teacher viewing it as a student or an admin viewing it as a student, it's never quite the same. So I would always have some test students on your site to see things for real. I don't know if you would agree with that, Anna.
Absolutely. I think it's the only way to do things. Usually have the main admin account, a second account for a student, and perhaps a third account for a teacher. I don't want to mess up the accounts and change all the time, logging and log out. So I'm using different browsers with different logins saved in every time. I'm doing those changes. Lynn is saying that do all site users see all courses, even if they are not enrolled?
Well, on a normal Moodle site, they can see the names of the courses, but they can't get into them unless they're somehow enrolled. Yes. There are ways to hide it, but the short answer is they can only see the titles.
Hilary says that I would like my teachers to be able to access all the courses and see information on students in all the courses, but I don't necessarily want the teachers to be able to make changes to the courses. What is the best role for the teachers in this case?
What you could do, and again, as long as this is safe in terms of privacy and GDPR and so on, is you could create a site-wide non-editing teacher role that could go into all of the courses. And I do remember there is a page in the documentation about this. It reminds me that if you have some extra questions, then you're very welcome to ask your extra questions in one of the forums of our Moodle Admin Basics courses that I'm going to share with you in a moment. And the community members, or often me, because I love answering questions, can give you some more details or point you in the right direction. So there are various site roles that people could have to access all courses and yet not be visible, but it involves more than we have time to explain in this webinar.
And a nice comment from William says that I always enroll my dog as a student.
Ah, excellent. Excellent idea. Your dog must be very clever then, I would imagine.
Yep. And that's all from the side at the moment.
Okay. Well, I just have one. Oh, is that all, Anna? Sorry.
Yes.
I just have one more section, just one more slide to share with you. And then we will start to wrap up the session. And in this one more slide, find out more, We've covered such a lot and you had so many other questions. Obviously, we don't have more time. So I want to point out three areas. First of all, a reminder that when you are an admin on your new Moodle site, Moodle 4, click the question mark icon bottom right of each page and go to the help and documentation, which is the Moodle Docs. Or you could go directly to docs.moodle.org, which is the full link to all of the documentation. And you see the link there says moodle.org, which again is our global site where the community discuss, download Moodle, how to be an administrator or a teacher. And so there are many forums in different languages on there. I'm in the French, German, Russian and English ones at the moment. And you're very welcome to ask questions in there. But if you are completely new to Moodle Admin, on this site, Moodle Academy, we have a program of courses called Admin Basics, specifically designed for you. And in fact, in there are also discussion forums. And so Moodle Admin Basics program and certificate is entirely free. You get, you can go through everything free. You get a free badge for each of the courses. If you want to, you can purchase a certificate. I know some employers appreciate that, but it's not obligatory. You can complete the courses and the program with badges for free without. But it takes you through in much more detail what we've done in this 1 hour webinar. Okay, now, and I do advise you, if you haven't already, to look up for that at the end of this webinar. Unless there are any more questions, I'm just going to share with you some other general things about getting involved in Moodle Academy.
Well, actually, there is one more question from Andrew, which is, okay, it's a bit big. What are the key changes from Moodle 3 to 4?
Right, the simple short answer, go and do two courses. One is called Moodle 4 for admins. One is called Moodle 4 for educators. They are on Moodle Academy and they tell you the key changes from Moodle 3 to Moodle 4.
Yep. And Alex already provided the link of the new features from the documentation. Thank you, Alex.
Oh, thank you. Right.
So, we can move on, Marie.
Right then. So, thank you for attending our webinar. I'd love to see some of you again next week in our Moodle for Educators, Introduction to Moodle for Educators. And we'd love you to help us grow our site, Moodle Academy. Ways that you could do this would be to join our Get Involved course. The link is on the front page, and suggest topics to be covered in future webinars and courses. And also, if you are an experienced Moodler, you might like to volunteer yourself to contribute to webinars. We've had a few already and we have a few in preparation where you will get a presenter's badge and you can help us. And again, to contribute to our courses, contribute to creating courses and get a course builder badge. So go to the Get Involved course to find out more about how you can help us spread the word and grow Moodle Academy. In terms of spreading the word, as I said, do please go to other courses here on Academy and earn some badges, which you can then display on social media. Tell others about Moodle Academy. Go to Twitter, Facebook. Tell people about this webinar, next week's webinar. And not necessarily applicable to our admin basics, unless you're also a teacher, educator, as well as an admin. But if and when you become an experienced teacher with Moodle, you might like to explore doing our Moodle Educator Certification Program, which is a paid program through our Moodle partners. But if you're curious to know if you have the right level of skills and experience, we have a quiz, Are You Ready for the MEC?, which you could take just to see the kinds of level you need. So all of these are things related to Moodle Academy. And we've been very grateful and thankful for your attendance today. And thank you very much from me and from Anna.